if when you give someone candy, but there's medicine in it, they're more likely to be able to digest
it. Digest
it.
Yeah.
It's the way, if you're doing it like, preach. You gotta be intellectual and lexical. Like, you know, like, man might not take that. Like, they're not taking it in like that.
You know what it is, Chuckie Online, Mixtape Madness, NFL, Jason, Osi. How you doing, my brothers?
Doing well, great to be back with you. Great to have another wonderful conversation, my brother.
I was in your world. We did the skills challenge. We did all of that. Learned how to do some stuff. That was a full vibe. I said we have to do this again. Mm. You know what I mean? Even the guests that we have today, I feel like we should kind of make them do a few of the catching, kicking and that. We need to try and work this out somehow, way, shape or form. Yeah.
Is that why your shoes are off? Because you're a little sore from all the skills challenge?
No. That was light work for me. I can't even lie. All of that was light work for me. Yeah. But this is my favorite part as well, because I love, if there's one thing I love doing, yeah, I love talking about my culture. I love talking about like the things that we represent and also just the way that the scene has grown, because I feel, and maybe this is a biased opinion from me, but I feel like I come from a special place with unique identities and also with some special talent and that as well. I got two people that I know, haven't seen for a little while that I hear, had a bunch of conversations with them, Krept and Konan. How you doing, my guys? I feel like I've seen everything from the beginning because I was a part of it. But I wanted to connect you so that you could kind of, you know, get an understanding of like who these guys are, where they come from, and like also just to broaden the conversation on a few other things that I have going on here. But firstly, how are you lot? I have not even seen you for time.
In a second.
Yeah.
I'm good though, we're good.
Yeah, 100.
Busy though.
Is it, yeah?
Yeah, busy. You gotta stay busy, man.
Busy.
Because I was gonna say, it's like, it feels like you've taken a break, but element of that may have been by force, innit? Because COVID and all of these type of things, innit? It's taken a whole year away out of our life. For me, even like, we're currently recording this in 2021, but it still feels like it's not even that. It feels like we're going into 2021 because we missed a whole year.
Yes,
man. You know what I'm saying?
Hey.
But like, you took a little break. Mm. What been going on?
A lot, bro. Yeah. For me, I've had a daughter since, I think the last time I even had a conversation. Yeah, so that was a whole thing within itself. Mm. We started loads of different projects in terms of, you know, businesses. We've got loads of things going on behind the scenes.
Did you start a jewelry business? Because not to focus, but I difficult for me to focus on anything you're saying right now. Jesus Christ.
Nah. Yeah, we started a few businesses. We're about to reopen our restaurant again. recording new music.
Yeah,
you know what it is? Because it's last project that we're doing in our deal.
Right.
Not our last project that we're doing, but our last project that we're doing in our deal, we've been in our deal for 8 years. So we want to go out with a bang, you get me? 8, 9 years, I think, isn't it?
Eight years.
Yeah, obviously when it hits 2022.
So
it'll be
9.
Sorry, yeah.
Mm. You know, there's bare things I want to talk to you about with regards to that, but that's for another day, yeah? But you know, even with the label thing quickly, yeah? Yeah. You know, like sometimes when people are at their last project on the album, sometimes like it's almost like that's rushed because you want to get out of it.
No, but we would have been out already.
That was the mindset originally. Like,
yeah.
Let's just fling out.
Let's just bang it out.
Let's get the hell out of there. And it was like, obviously, man, I had to double back and be like, nah, man, like you want to leave on a high. Do you know what I'm saying? You don't want to put out when you're leaving. You want to make sure that you do the best you can. So then when you leave, the opportunities are still coming in because of the last thing you did. You get it? You're always judged on the last thing you've done, innit? So if you put out something that's meaty and just rushed, people are gonna be like, oh, they're done, man. They're done, whatever. Like the music's not sounding as good, you get me? So I feel like we just wanted to make something sick. So it's like, okay, it's better than the last stuff. They're getting better and better. Mm. So now they're free. What are they gonna do next? You get me? So it leaves the anticipation.
I find that interesting because, you know, a lot of times you see artists, right, and they're like having problems with their record label, right, towards the end. So they almost want to do something to get out, right? Yeah, just put something out there. But if you do that, then your music sucks and then you suffer in the end, right? So how do you balance that?
You just kind of you gotta ignore like the politics, man, and just remember what you came in is for, to make good music, you get me? So that's the mindset. Like, obviously you want to get out, you want to own everything, you want to be the, but at the same time, it's like you're here because you love music and you want to give the fans something good. So always focus on that and everything will come after, I feel like.
And to the fans as well, remember, they don't look at it as this music was signed and this music was independent.
Right. Yeah.
They don't know.
They just look at it for music. Whatever you're giving me is what I'm taking. I don't care that you think they're going to listen to this and think, nah, they rushed this because they were coming out of it.
They don't give excuses.
This is trash, bro. I don't care. So
the first thing I thought is you two sitting here, 9 years in the game together.
No, longer. That's just nine years of being signed.
So how long total?
Since we done our first song together when we were 14. So like that was 2004.
Wow. That's 17 years ago, right?
Yeah, we done our first song together. You get me?
So, and you can feel the vibe. You can feel like the respect. How has that happened? Because that doesn't occur in this business a lot. People aren't able to stay together, stick together, and come together and make a good product, whatever that is.
Yeah.
Like that's interesting. How have y'all been able to maintain that?
We both always had the same goal, same, you know what I'm saying? And where, like, I feel like a lot of people, you know, money changes the situation. Like, people get greedy.
Egos, pride.
Yeah, like, whereas with us, it's just whatever we're doing, we're in it together. Like I don't care if I did this much stuff or he did this much stuff. We split it, like, we're here together. Do you get what I'm saying?
Because when you get, like, money, like, you bring your friends anyway. So the fact that I'm just with my brethren, it's easier. Do you know what I'm saying? Anything we're going into, we're going in together.
Yeah.
Like when you're by yourself.
The losses are together as well.
Yeah, like, you get what I'm saying? And it's just like, it's harder when you're by yourself, I feel like. When you got to go on that first stage by yourself. When you got to go in that first interview by yourself. When you got to go abroad by yourself. I'm always with my friend. Do you get what I'm saying? So that just makes it always better.
Did anything happen that made you guys this type? Because what he said is a very, very good question. A lot of times people get to a certain level and...
And then money changes. I feel like it's just our characters. Like, we're coming from the same place. Like, we're coming with the same hunger. We're coming from the same ends. Like, we've witnessed a lot of things. We've gone through a lot of things together. And the end goal, we have an end goal, and the end goal is huge. So this is just groundwork to get there. And
to be fair, yeah, obviously I went through a situation where like I lost my stepdad and I was homeless and et cetera, et cetera. And we was together when that was happening. We were always together.
It's a stronger bond.
Yeah, it's stronger because we went through the trauma. He was with me when we went through the trauma. So it's like when we're going through it and I'm like nearly losing myself, he's trying to keep me, you get me, sane. And we're sitting in his car talking about how we're going to do this. And when no one's giving us any like ratings or like the labels don't want to sign you on radio, don't want to play you, we're together, like stressed out together in the car, like what are we going to do next? So it's like when you get to the goal, it's like we're not going to then now, oh no, fuck you. You get what I'm saying? Yeah. It's like we're going all the way. So we know this game's full of snakes, leeches, fake love, and the only real love is us two. So it's like that's what we got to get through, you know what I'm saying? You always revert back to that. So I feel like
that makes y'all powerful, man.
Yeah, for real.
100.
Mm. And like you've experienced that all in it, really. I think like the thing that I kind of find the most interesting now is, yeah, see, for me, like recently, I went back to my old block where I grew up, and it's weird, you know, like now it's a lot more quieter than it was when I was growing up. When I was there, when I was young, everyone was outside. There was bad things going on. When I go down there, I think, what, is everyone playing computer? I think maybe because everyone's playing computer games or whatever it is, everyone's just in their yard now. But in my head though, when I'm there, even though there's no one outside, I can still see everyone. It's like, you know that, it's like your mind's taking you back there, yeah?
Like you're mentally there.
Right. See, as men now, yeah? See, when you go back to where you come from, do you ever do that, actually? Do you ever literally just go straight back to literally the road, the street, the parks, and all of that occasionally and just reflect?
Yeah, man, like, always got to, like, you get what I'm saying? I'm always, like, where I'm from, I'm always there, innit? Like, I always got to go there, got to go back there, check people there. So, like, and it's just mad, like, because It's weird because I feel like loads of other areas have been like gentrified in it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
My area hasn't been touched.
Yeah, that's
what I'm saying. Left it.
It's literally, is it the same?
It's the exact same.
Is it like, see, in terms of it being the same?
So it's the
is
same.
Is it like the same, yeah, even just with like just bare utes running around, all of that type of stuff? Like literally,
just
the
a
same
different
feeling.
Generation. Mm. Yeah, like you go and see the young G's and the ends, and it's just them, but in a different generation and a different era of things. You get what I'm saying? But I feel like, I don't know, I feel like our generation, we had like Yale on the block and it was, these are just crazy. They're just vexed. Like, I don't know what's going on, everyone's just vexed. But yeah, no, but when you go there, it's just, it does, like, I'm always just reminded of the stuff we was going through. I'll look at the block, I remember, oh, when this happened, or when that happened, or when this happened, do you get me? So yeah, man, it's always good to go there and just like reminisce. And even when I was there with my brethren the other day and was talking about, like, all the stuff that kind of happened and how nothing's changed. Even the fact that nothing has been gentrified, how comes they ain't touched our ends? Like, why? What's wrong with our ends? Why is everyone else getting the refurbs and our block's just the same block?
Same like, block.
Just looks nuts still.
Do you feel like the youth are a little bit more disrespectful now than they were before?
Has things changed
on that level or no?
Do you know what I think? The only thing that's changed is the internet.
Yeah.
Like before, stuff was happening. If the internet was probably there back in the day, we probably would have seen some crazy stuff being posted and loads, but it just wasn't there, like in terms of, you know, mobile devices, Instagram, Snapchats, this wasn't there. We had, what did we have? MSN.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, literally.
And Blackchat.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Like, that was, you have to log in and
scraping
dial up internet.
Blackberry, yeah, yeah.
Blackberry was on there scraping on that.
Scraping in, you know, like a little Blackberry, like, and a little broadcast on a Blackberry, like, yo. But that was it. Like, was now.
Blackberry was like a revolutionary thing when that lit.
Nah, it was crazy.
I bet y'all thought you would have a Blackberry forever.
Yeah, yeah.
No, like, I've never given this thing up.
But yeah, like, but when you think about how crazy it is now, I can take a picture of you right now, take a picture, upload it, the world can see it right now.
Hold the world.
Straight away. Where we are, video. Put a filter on your face.
Get a response.
Yeah, facts.
Can do a dance and put it up. It's up, it's on the internet.
Yeah.
Now, right to now.
Like, I wonder though if like...
It's nuts.
I wonder if like the way that they see success and the way that we saw success has changed though.
Yeah,
and the reason
percent.
Why?
Million percent.
Why did you say that?
Because the goalpost has moved, didn't it?
Right.
Like before it was like, you get on radio, it was crazy. You get like a top 40, it was crazy. Like, oh, you see a man driving a TT, it was crazy. Now it's like, right, I want a Lambo truck. Like,
yeah,
that's
standard. Yeah,
like, do you get what I'm saying? Like for the youths, oh, I want an RM, I want a Patek, I want a, like, do you get what I'm saying? When I, like, a 15-year-old probably knows what a Patek is and an RM.
Yeah, that's crazy.
And when I was young, it was a Rolex only.
Yeah.
Like, do you get me? I knew what a Rolex was. That's about it, probably from Biggie, Rolex side to side. That was the only watch I knew. Now they know everything. They know all the designer names. They know, do you get what I'm saying? It's standard for them. Do you get what I'm saying? Whereas that wasn't standard for us. Like, I would still, you still get ratings for getting a night coat.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
That night coat's crazy. Yeah. Now it's raw, Balenciaga
like
coat.
And like that.
You get the Yeezys are like two bags free. You get what I'm saying? It's crazy.
But you got your work cut out with your daughter, you know?
Why?
Because see, when she starts getting older, it's the things that she's seen, like her presents are going to look nuts.
Virtual reality.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, no, of course, but that's why I'm working so hard now, you get me?
Yeah,
to meet the demand.
They don't like Basquiat painting.
Yeah, bro.
Hey, this is his early work.
Like, I got to be gifted a crypto and that.
Yeah, that's it. I'm telling you.
Different vibes, bro.
I will say this. I was listening to some of y'all lyrics, and one thing I really appreciated is you would drop these, like, financial nuggets in there about things you're doing, how you invest in, decisions you're making. So when you talk about the youth, you talk about your neighborhood, I feel like that, given those nuggets, people are listening.
Facts, yeah.
You know, we find solutions to our problems through our peers or those older than us that are from where we are.
Of course.
And doing that and saying that, I feel like that's so important. I mean, I look at the artists that I grew up listening to, the things they said mattered. And doing that, you're having this song, you're saying these things, but you're constantly like feeding them information. I just think that's really dope. What was that a conscious shift, or that's just life as it is?
It's literally like life and, you know, maturing and accepting responsibilities and actually understanding that people are listening to you sometimes, you get me? And and it's all good, you know, glamorizing, you know, girls and women and this and that and whatever. But then what about sustainability and actual real life situations and saying things that actually are gonna affect your life? Like, do you get what I'm saying? And I feel like that's just something that we've always been like. We've always thought about the future. So I think the fact that we drop things in there for not to fall on deaf ears is important, you feel me? So
I don't, I can't even speak for you, man, but I just feel as well, like, growing up, we just wasn't taught a lot of things.
Like, we was taught, you know what I'm saying? I feel like we was taught a lot of things, but not anything that was important.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like, well, not important, because, you know, no one has to do math. Yeah. But I mean, like, there's things that I feel like I'm missing from the curriculum.
And it's even mad that you was taught that, and sometimes man didn't even listen to that. So,
I feel like they should talk
to you. Do you get what I'm saying? It's
like,
crazy.
About your credit. I wish I knew about my credit from school, and they say how important it is. Don't mess up your credit. Don't do this.
What, did they say that in school?
No, they should have.
Oh yeah.
Like, I just feel like they don't mention it, like mortgages, tax, and all of this stuff. I just feel like it's, you know what I'm saying?
Those are life skills.
Yeah, just life skills. Like real life. You want to get a mortgage and just things like what you need to do in order to get that, and just things that we should probably know, that they just gems that they are just untold. Like, we've got a financial advisor who's told us some gems. It's like, I feel like this is illegal.
Yeah, the way he's breaking down.
Like, he's saying certain things that taxes, like, and you are able to get tax money back to invest in this. I'm like, what?
Do you get
like,
what I mean?
And it's just like, they don't tell you that the gems that you should know, like, coming into this world. And it's just like, why? If I find it so mad that they just don't tell us.
But do you think that people want to hear
if I told you you can get 50% of your money that you invest back, you're gonna say you're not gonna be interested in it?
No. Of course I would. But I'm saying, like, if you hear, I'm talking about, like, musically speaking, right?
Yeah.
If you hear people who are sometimes saying some real, real stuff, like things that really matter, right?
Yeah.
You see that they probably sell records and it'd be right here.
It's how you say it.
You think so?
Do you know what they call it? Do you know what it is? It's medicine in the candy.
Like, for example,
medicine in the candy.
Yeah. Yeah.
If when you give someone candy, but there's medicine in it, they're more likely to be able to digest it.
Way.
Yeah.
It's the way, if you're doing it like, preach. You gotta be intellectual and next-able. Man might not take that. Like, they're not taking it in like that. You get what I'm saying?
But
if you say, I was gonna bust the Patek, but the watch just tripled in price.
Right.
You'd be like, I like that.
Yeah, I might get a bit of
that. You feel me? Like, there's ways you say things and the way you deliver it. If you deliver it in a way that's fly and that's lit, then I'm taking it in.
Yeah.
You get me? But that's the difference. I ain't trying to do it in a journalistic way, bro.
Yeah.
You get what I'm saying? Yeah. Be real with them, but yeah, you listen to me.
The way you're doing it takes more talent, though.
Mm. Yeah, it's because you're thinking about delivering it in that way, like, so man can take it in.
Yeah. You're
still trying to get that when they hit the bar, you get what I mean, so.
Just before COVID hit, I knew a few people that were literally just starting restaurants or whatever, and you'd already been in the game for a little while.
Mm. Which is kind of going
back to, like, an element of looking after the community and putting something back in the hood and employing people from that area. Like me, I'm going there, I'm seeing a lot of young people that are working in this restaurant. The restaurant's called Crepes and Cones, by the way, which is a play off their names or whatnot. Yeah. But like,
we'll be there.
You closed it, right?
Yeah, we closed for COVID, but then we've got some new people in to redo everything, and just when we reopen, it's a lot more smoother than it was when before. You get what I'm saying?
Was that the most difficult business venture that you did, though?
Yeah, easily. Like, because it requires you to actually be there.
Man, you're dealing with, like, different people every day. Like, literally, from the waiters to the chef to the people that's just coming in.
Dealing with emotions every single day.
Like, you get what I'm saying? You can come in there one day and the chef's going through something mad in his house and then he's just cooking the food nuts.
No, that's facts.
You don't think about it.
That's facts. Yeah, like, yeah. And then he's serving you burnt planting.
And then when
you
get
they're
burnt
posting
planting,
about it.
And then the people that are coming to buy the food, they're now on one, like, look at my planting, it's burnt. Krept Konan watched, tweeting, and they're bro, it's the chef, he had a mad day yesterday. So
that's the thing, like, people are always gonna when
come
you have
to
a
us
like
regardless.
That, they associate you with the food with you.
Yeah.
So you are the one, the way that they see it is, you're in the kitchen cooking it up.
With the hat on and right. The apron. That's what they think.
that's how they treat it, you get what I'm saying? But obviously that's what comes with putting a
name to something, yeah.
Your name to a brand and they're gonna come to you, even though it's not your fault and you've already set a precedent. But that's the thing, like, because we can't physically be in a restaurant every day making sure, it's difficult, because usually people start a restaurant, they're in there. You see Salt Bae, he's in there, bro.
That's for real, because he's in there,
Don's in there. Like, if they're moving mad, he's there with them. Like, and they're not going to move mad. You get what I'm saying? You can be in there all the time, but we can't, because we've got our careers and we've got stuff that we need to do. So we have to rely on someone to make sure everybody's patterned. Mm. And that person, their self is trying to cut through. Do you get what I'm saying? Because they're people trying to get away with as much as they can get away with just in life. So they're not going to... Work, everybody on some if like they can get away with not having to do that. So, and then you've got to find someone that you can trust to actually do that, and you know what I'm saying? And then you've got to offer incentives and this, that. And it's a lot, bro.
Think your experience from the music business gave you kind of those solutions, or you got problems that happen in all of your endeavors, but seems like you're coming with these solutions to these problems so quickly. Did that come from all of that experience in the music industry?
So a lot of things came from the music industry, but with the restaurant, that was a new experience. Mm. I can't lie to you.
Dealing with people, obviously, because you're in the music game, you're dealing with fans, and one day they love you and one day they don't. Mm. So it's like, you get that experience from the music, dealing with like people's personalities and knowing that one day it could be happy and sad. But then the whole experience as a whole, like, that was brand new, bro. Like, it's crazy.
But I can't lie,
it's like a reality show.
That was crazy. But what I learned from that restaurant, running that restaurant, I learned so much. And we've been able to apply it to so much new stuff.
Right.
Mm.
Like what?
Like new businesses. How to what not to do and what to do,
what you need and what you don't need.
What you do need, what you don't need.
Paying overheads and
like just so much things. Like it made me think of so much things, and you know what I'm saying? And you start thinking about how can we start a business that has no overheads? Mm. Because you got all these overheads and you got this and you got that. It's like, okay, cool. And you just start thinking in a different way. And then you start doing
especially through COVID as well. Like, how do you get a business that can run through COVID without it affecting you? Do you get what I mean?
That's a massive obstacle. Like, I was talking to someone just the other day, she was saying to me, they were talking about New Year's resolutions and that. I was like, I don't even make them. Like, my last resolution I still have in my head, which is don't force the issue. I came up with that like 6 years ago and that just stays in my head, And she was like, well, you know what? Every year is the same. And I'm like, well, yeah and no. We just had a whole pandemic, which is a whole next madness, And in that, like, so many of us had to find different ways of adjusting and maneuvering in careers and businesses and stuff like that in a way that you could not even nearly fathom. Like, ain't no one thinking about, yo, I've got a restaurant and at some point we're just gonna have to try and make it takeaways and we're gonna have to try and make that work. Also, the aspect of, you know what, I actually care about you lot that work for me and I want to make sure that you've got some money in your pocket. But then there's that catch-22 as well, like, right, we're going to have to let go of some people. We're going to have to, you understand what I'm saying? Mm. Like, how was dealing with that part of the business already, it being difficult, now being in this part, like, how was it maneuvering with that?
It was mad, bro. Like, to, because we're already still figuring out the just running it normally when the world is normal.
This is it.
So like we still didn't even have that to a T yet. Do you get what I'm saying? To then be hit in a pandemic where it's like, and bearing in mind, we've made a restaurant that the whole purpose of it is to come there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Right. That's part of the experience.
Like,
yeah,
it's not, yeah, we built the we built private rooms for big groups, and that's where we made most of our money's from, big groups of parties, and you come, drink, vibes, music. That is what we sold.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So when you're telling man you can't sell that, and now you just got, like, we was just fucked, basically. Do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So then it, we just had to, luckily, obviously, we done well to the point where we was riding out this whole, you get what I'm saying, this madness. We was riding through it just based on stuff that we just done and everything that we've done. But yeah, I'm not gonna say it was easy, bro. Like, it wasn't. We was thinking, oh, fuck this, man. Let's just pack it in.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Do you get what I'm saying? And then there were people was coming in saying, no.
Don't do it. Keep it alive.
Like, you've got a gold mine checking up. Like, you've done all of this by winging it, because we winged it, because our friend who was meant to do it passed away. So we're here winging it. Like, we had no manager. We launched with no manager. Just me and Cones and our brethren, just
literally winging it, bro.
Winging it, like
you saw from when we first opened it, we was in there.
People thought we was doing that for PR. We wasn't. We had to be there.
like my sister's in there, his sister's in there, my mum's in there, like my brother's in there.
Like we're family, in there, bro. Everyone's like, oh, we're in there, bro. Mad, like we're winging it, bro. Like.
Yeah, I went there one time with my brother and you was there.
Yeah. One of us was there. Yeah. Do you get what I'm saying? Like, but the fact that we had to do that. Do you get what I'm saying? Like, it wasn't easy, bro. Like,
you know, I find that so interesting. I'm gonna tell you why I find that interesting. It's because I went through something similar, right? Yeah. I played for the NFL. I was in the NFL. Played for the Giants. I came out here and I heard this music. My wife introduced me to it from Brazil, right? Called Bahia Funk. I don't know if you know Bahia Funk music. It's like the hip hop from like the gutter of Brazil.
Okay,
right?
Okay, got you.
So I heard that sound and I had never heard anything like that before. And I was like, golly, you know what would be so cool? Because the beat is so dope. But I was like, you know, if somebody could make this, because they speak Portuguese, they rap in Portuguese. Mm. And I was like, if somebody could make this in like English, right? With that beat, it would be crazy. Mm. So I said, you know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna start a record label. I bullshit you not. This is a true story. Started a record label called The Uprise. Went, got some really good rappers. You know, we went, they started making these beats, you know what I mean? So we in the studio. I don't know nothing about music. Never been in that industry before. But just the idea of somebody making these songs with this beat in English, you know, appealed to me. I was like, yeah, I got it. You know, let's do it. And did this for like 2 years. It was a struggle because I don't know anything about the music industry. I just decided to jump head into something that I had no clue about, right?
That's like us.
Yeah, it was tough. It was really, really difficult, man. But you learn so much from that experience, right? And the whole time as I'm looking at all these different cultures, whether it's the Brazilian blacks, you could hear in that in the beat, you could hear like a little bit of Afrobeat, right? Mm. And you could hear some grime. You could hear some Caribbean. You could hear all that type of stuff in the music. So I was like, man, the connection of black people is so, to me, it was so cool to do that, right? Mm. But I still didn't know anything about the music, right? And so what I eventually ended up doing was transitioning and using that same idea and actually bringing in something that I knew about, which was football, right? And so now we started NFL Africa, which is the exact same type of thing, but I know damn well about the NFL. Yeah, I know that well. But I've now taken that same experience and put it into something completely different, and it's gonna flourish. So hearing you guys talk about that was, it was crazy to me because I've been through it before.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's
the first, I was thinking, I was like, I wonder what this experience, obviously y'all have did so much and experienced so much, the ups and downs. Now coming out of that, going back in the lab, working on music, was there a shift? How has that changed how you, your process of making great music? Has it done anything to that?
For me, I was like, I felt like I even during COVID and lockdown, I was still like booking sessions and going to studio. So it's like, no matter what's going on, we don't forget
the music.
Yeah, of course.
The main thing.
So we'll be in the booth, like, through our whole lockdown, like, randomly, I think, like, twice a week, man was just going to the studio.
Yeah, like, he'll be in that, well, because it was COVID, mm-hmm. he would be there one day.
Then he will be there. Day.
So we just,
yeah, like, and we just keep that music inspiration. Yeah, yeah, because yeah, once you, like, I feel like, it's like if we was doing that for a whole year, then COVID, and then imagine we didn't write a lyric this whole time.
Yeah, it's mad.
I'll be in like, I went to the shop and I forgot how to rap, fam.
Yeah, yeah.
You get me? So I feel like, yeah, like that's just something that we keep doing. Like always just like testing out your ability and it's like practice.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Going in a booth, like you go out there and try new things all the time. It doesn't ever have to reach anyone's ears.
True.
Yeah.
You know I'm saying? You just go in there and just see what we can do and see what we can make and just keep testing the boundaries. And we're always trying to push the boundaries and sounds.
Yeah, you've been just, doing that stuff.
Yeah, do you get
I me? Think that, you know what, yeah? From a music geek aspect, I think later on down the line, that's something that people that love music, yeah? And people that have like been, maybe even been a part of the culture or just seen what's been happening, I think a real big conversation with you two in particular is like the boundaries that have been pushed, but the different times and periods that you've been about. Because I feel like at every period of time, say for example, when it was like a really big deal to have a mixtape in the, you know, top 10 or whatever it may be, you did that mad early. Mm-hmm. Do you understand what I'm saying? When it came to doing certain types of shows, venues and that, did that mad early. Mm. Businesses, restaurants, did that mad early. And all of these, like, in all of this time, going through, remember what you were saying, like the highs and lows of dealing with just humans anyway. Do you find, you particularly, Konan, yeah. do you find dealing with the social media aspect of things more frustrating than ever now? Bro, The reason why I see that, because sometimes I see you online, yeah, and you just look,
bro, I'll be honest, yeah. Bro, I am jarred.
I know.
It annoys me. Like social media actually annoys me. Even talking about it now, it annoys me.
It's changing your whole mood.
Like, changing my whole mood. Like, more time you see me, I don't even post a lot. Or I don't video, because it just annoys me.
Yeah.
I feel like as soon as I do something or say something, they're on me.
Yeah.
They're on me. They're trying to switch my words. They're trying to tell me. Like, me particularly, I feel like they just want a problem with me. Yeah. And I don't know why, bro. It so annoys me. But I get on with it, innit? I laugh about it. I don't get it twisted. Like, at the time when I'm doing it, I'm impulsive, innit? So when the motion hits me, I'm like, and I'm just there chatting with my mouth off. You get me? And then after, I just laugh about it. These lot will phone me like, bro, you're hilarious. And I'm not even trying to be funny.
Yeah, yeah. Like, sometimes,
it's hilarious.
As well.
So
because you can see that you're trying to... You're annoyed, but you're trying to not show too much frustration. But it's evident that you're pissed off now.
Yeah.
And it's mad because, as a parallel, you're so different. Like, it's like you don't even really give a shit.
I couldn't care.
But you seem like you seem like it really just proper just annoys you.
No, it annoys me.
Nah, do you know what it is with me?
Sounds like me and him. I'm over here cracking up. He has to keep me from jumping off the deep end. He's like, relax, man. Don't let it bother you.
Nah, because it's obviously it's real, but it's not real, bro. Because I swear to you, we've been doing music for however many years, bro. Not one person has said anything negative in real life. Ever.
Right.
No,
ever.
No one has said nothing
ever in real life.
Like, ever, bro. Yeah. Like, ever.
Like, I've never experienced someone saying anything negative.
Can I tell you something funny about rap, by the way, just quickly, yeah? Is that, when the internet is on to them, for whatever reason, yeah? Do you know what they'll do? They'll feel like the world's on to them, for whatever reason, yeah? Their man will just go Selfridges in Oxford Street, just, I'm outside. I'm outside, imagine Selfridges. It's like, no one don't hate you like that. Like,
nobody bought that.
Yeah, everyone's supposed to take a picture.
I'm
in Selfridges if it's really that fun thing.
It's true. But you know what it is? I've realized that a lot of the time people just want to say something that gets the most likes,
to build up their thing.
Yeah.
So, like, people are just doing it, like, to just do it. I can say something funny on this. Everyone's talking about this. Let me say something funny. Let me chime in and get little retweets, little LOLs. And that's more time all it is. It's not even a personal thing. I never forget,
someone sent me a mad message, yeah, like, you're fucking shit. Like, I used to listen to you back in the day. You're shit. You're done. Da-da-da-da-da. Like, why are you dropping dead songs? Like, I think it was when we dropped Pour Me Another One. Someone was like, dead song. Where's the... Nah, you fucking shit. Da-da, fuck you. Fuck your family. Fuck this. Fuck that. And I just messaged them and said, are you okay? I said, are you all right? No, seriously, are you all good? And then they responded like, nah, you know what, fam? Like, yeah, I've just been going through a lot. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I was just like, is this the people that are projecting this stuff? They're just upset in their own life. Like, yeah. Think about it. Yeah, think about it. If you had all the money in the world, you're happy, you're in a good space, family, friends, health, are you going to be saying anything negative on a comment on about
it? You don't have time for it.
No, you ain't going to.
You don't care.
So you do not care.
You don't. So I know anyone that has time to do all of that, they're going for it, fam.
Do you know how much time I might go to say something and just delete it?
That's a fact.
No, but I don't. It don't anger me. No, it used to. There was a stage where I used to get, like, even when Mandem would do, like, comparisons about lists and...
That stuff used to piss me.
Bro, I don't give a fuck about nothing anymore.
Konan does.
I don't care.
No, you do, though.
Let me tell you why.
I'm the deadest. I can't spit. It's like they're dead. Our tunes are dead. Like, go
the Mandem is in a world where it's like you lot love music the same way man loves music, right? And we all know what's good and what's bad.
Do we?
I would hope the Mandem would be close to knowing who's going in.
Do you know why we can't say that?
Objective, but.
You know why you can't say that? Because I know there's people that put out songs and you're like, why did you think that was a sick song? Mm. But they thought that was sick in the studio.
No, I hear you, but the people that's in man's realm, like that's got
no, but I'm talking about man that are in man's realm.
They're the people that
no, but if the if that's from the own, our own peers that are making weird songs, like that makes me think it's subjective. Everyone thinks.
No, of course it's subjective, but I would just feel like the man would rate man's thing, innit? Like, that's what I was thinking. Like, bro, I'm going in. What are you talking about? Like, how do you not see that? Are you not blind? Are you not, like, turning a blind eye to this? Because if we both go on the same tune with the person that you're rating, I'm going to do them. Let me know it as well. So why are we pretending like we're not doing this stuff that's good?
I'll be honest with you. I'm a sensitive character at times, innit? Mm. I am, innit? And I understand that. But the thing is, it's when you are enlightened and you're like, okay, cool. Like, because there's the difference between, like, sensitivity and the behavior side. So, like, what is it really? Like, you know that you're cold. Like, and
no, but
you know
I what? Feel sometimes like with man thing, is man not cold then?
Yeah, like, you see us, we're the kind of, like, to be honest, yeah, like, obviously man thinks man's good at music or whatever, yeah? But then there's days when you think, am I? Like,
right.
Because to be fair, subjective, isn't it? Like, you see the people that go on X Factor and they're mad singing and they're mad shit, but they think they're actually good. And you don't want to ever feel delusional, like, am I going in or am I not? So when you hear somebody saying, nah, they don't mention you, or you don't think, wait, hold on a sec, I thought that was good. Like, right. And remember, we're in the studio, like, I'm a perfectionist, ask him, like, I'll be changing, like, words. It'll be, like, go from and to or, like, I'm changing that.
Right, right.
Like, so when I'm doing all of that and then I put out, a piece and then everyone's like ignoring it, or not ignoring it, but the man them that I respect their opinion are like not really paying attention to it, or saying whatever. Yeah. It's like, wait, hold on a second, what's going on here?
Yeah.
You get what I'm saying? And they make man reevaluate things, you get what I mean? So
there's definitely a big difference between, like, when you feel like your peers aren't rating you,
right. Yeah,
as opposed to when it's just the guy with, like, chips coming down his chin.
Yeah.
There's a difference, right? And I know exactly what
I was going to say the same for you as well. Yeah, like, obviously in your career, you would have had moments where early on, not having to deal with the fun aspect of it.
Yeah.
If anything, you're just dealing with your coaches or what you're hearing just within your immediate circle. But as things change, obviously, you know, pundits get bigger. That becomes a thing that is, like, people latch onto the words of what, like, pundits say.
That's
and
true.
What, you know, people are saying online and stuff like that.
That's true.
Like, dealing with that in your field, like, how was that for you?
It was different. I think because we came from a an environment that wasn't really subjective. It was numbers. It was like, did you get this many sacks? Did you throw this many touchdowns? Like, it was like
proof in the pudding.
Yeah.
Purely
all or you did
numbers.
Everybody could see it.
Right. And so we went from that to now when we're doing TV and we're doing punditry, we're like presenting. Now it's no longer Now it's more subjective. It's now more like what people think. Oh, is this good? Is this not good? Some people like it, some people don't like it. So it's a completely different, we've ran the whole gamut of emotions from straight, oh, this is, did you do it or did you not? To now, you're having to rely on what people think. And it's difficult, man. It's really, really, it's a completely different environment that we're in right now.
I say, when we first sat down and I was listening to y'all and I just was locked in because all of a sudden my wheel started turning. And it became a little selfish. And I started thinking about our relationship, how we work together, how we're brothers, right? And a lot of the things that you were talking about is like imposter syndrome. It's like, am I really good at this? And I've questioned myself, especially in this genre of business that we're doing. But because of my relationship with him, when all the heat was happening, when I was questioning myself, the only person I cared about was what does he say? Am I doing this right? Am I being authentic? Am I being myself? Because all that other noise is distracting and you don't know really how to handle it as much as you want to avoid it. Like, I'm so old, it was don't look at the newspaper, you know? Don't look at the paper before the game. I made a mistake one time and did that. Didn't have a good game. I was like, never again. But now you can't avoid it because it's right there with you. But whenever I'm in that situation, I don't look outward. I look inward and to the person I trust that I'm on the battleground with. And he tells me, you know what, yeah, fix this or do that. I'm going to do that. But I trust what he's saying because his intentions are real. And I was looking at y'all and I was like, oh, I get this.
Yeah.
I see this. Like, oh, this is why when I'm listening to y'all music, this is why the longevity exists. And I was like, that's fresh.
Yeah, bro. Respect. Appreciate it.
Do you know what? Extreme confidence. I don't know if extreme confidence exists forever within a person. You know that. Like, you can have it. You tell me what you think about this, yeah? I feel like in moments of your career, you can have it. And those moments can be, you know what, like, either you're stepping onto the field or you're stepping onto the stage or whatever, yeah? And the confidence is, yeah, I'm gonna mash, I'm gonna do whatever. Or, you know what, that confidence might come afterwards. After you've had a sick performance, both sides, whatever it may be, you've had a sick performance, you come off and you're like, you know what, no one can't chat to me. But I think it's really normal to be able to turn around and actually say, you know what, like, oh, wait, like, I'm feeling a bit nervous about this, or like, am I this good? Do you know what I mean? Sometimes, for me, anytime I've ever felt that way, usually it's about proving myself to myself whether I am or not. Do you get what I'm saying? One of the reasons why I even started doing a podcast, when I wasn't getting the radio, I was thinking, Rob, am I even good enough to do this? This was like a real thing that was in me for time. But it was like, I have to prove this wrong in my head that like, no, I can actually do it. But every once in a while, every once in a while, I still will go through the moments where I'm like, I question stuff. Like, you know what, am I as good as this person says that I am? Or, you know, have I had an off day or an off week for X amount of period of time or whatever? And that starts to really beat you up. And that's why I feel like it's an honest thing for you to turn around and say, you know what, like, now sometimes I do say, you know what, like, am I good enough though? Like, is my pen still sharp?
That's what I was saying earlier. So it's like when you don't do the list and that, it'll be spilling my brain. Like, I have to go to the booth. I'll go back and listen to like songs that I've just made, or I go pen something. Like, that's how LA even came around.
Right.
When I done Last Night in LA, that song there,
yeah.
I remember there was little debates on Twitter about who's going in and who the top bars is and rah, rah, and I thought someone mentioned him and they didn't mention me. But right. The only reason why I saw it, because they was saying, what about Konan though? What about Konan? And it was like, okay, they don't rate me. I went home and I was in my house, right? And I went in the kitchen and I just started penning and that's right. When it came up.
But that's the attitude I think to have. Because you know what? The reality is, yeah, is that sometimes, no, it's just not always gonna bang. Do you get me?
No,
sometimes it's not. And sometimes, you know what? As a fan, I might turn around one day and say, you know what? Krep did a madness. Konan was a little bit off today.
No, and you know
it was a bit. And if you hear that, if you hear that and it makes you feel some type of way, without it letting you over consume you, you gotta do the LA thing. You gotta say, what? Is this what? Okay, boom. It's an LA thing. And you know what? Other times I might turn around and say, yeah, no, Krep didn't even really, that was shit. Can't even lie. My thing is never that. I'd never go on a platform and tell a man or say, this is shit. That's not my way of critiquing. I can't do that. My thing is always to just, give my personal opinion without like slandering a man's thing. I just don't really have that within me. But I think within this game, it's like sometimes managing opinions, innit? And like, it's the, I guess it's the unfortunate thing about it too, because it's what opinions are you taking in?
Do you think it's the work you put in that makes you so confident?
Right.
Is it or is it just like, do you believe like, I just got this gift, or I got this gift, but I got this grind? I mean, it's
both. I think it is both. It's like, yeah, you got the gift, but then the grind is what's made us be here. Mm. You know what I'm saying? Because there's probably a lot of talented people in the world that just don't want to put the work in, and they feel like they owed it because they got the talent. You know what I'm saying?
Because you can be dope, but if you're not grinding, like, no one's going to hear it, or you're not going to get out as many people as you feel like you should, then you're going to have, you're going to be bitter, you're going to be upset. So a lot of the time, yeah, when people are like, that whole thing of, oh, man ain't rating this, or man ain't rating, I just think, okay, man's just got to work harder then.
Facts.
Do you get what I'm saying? But then, it's sometimes like, but look at all the shit man's done though. But then it's like, clearly it's not enough, so let me go harder then.
Yeah, that's where it be.
Sometimes man's taste is off though. Sometimes you don't even have to work harder. Sometimes your taste is off.
Yeah, no, 100%. Like, you get what I'm saying? Like, sometimes people have been funny about tunes that I think are sick, and I'm like, I think this tune's sick. Like, we there's even tunes in our group chat where man's like, well, what do you think of my man's album? Man's like, I think it's hard. And man's like, really? I don't. So I just know that some people just don't. Everyone's got different opinions. Yeah, and so my thing is you just got to keep going, innit? Like, if I don't make this song for you, hopefully the next one you like. And hopefully it's enough that you're rating man in general.
Literally, you just got to keep going, bro.
You get what I'm saying?
Like, that's the...
Because that's where in the world we're in, bro. Like. Yeah, it's like that. It's like no one cares. Work harder.
Right.
Yeah, literally.
Right.
Like, how do you go about, like, rating other artists and other people's music, right? Because, like I said, until I started that record label, I had no idea how hard that stuff, what you guys do, I had no clue how hard it was. Like, it is, that shit's serious, right? And so you know that. You know how tough it is to make music, right?
Yeah.
So how do you go about rating other people's, like, oh, this is trash, this is good, this is bad, like, how do you go about doing that, being in that industry and understanding the difficulties it takes to make music?
I feel like, for me personally, I feel like if it gives me an emotion when I listen to it, then that's how I know it's good or not, for example. So if I listen to it and it gets me hyped and it's affecting me emotionally, like, I'm like, yo, like, and my face is screwing up, then I think, yeah, this is good. Or if I listen to it and it's, just, for example, a conscious song and it makes me want to hear them talking the conscious lyrics, like, and it's engaging me, then I think it's good. And if it's, like, for example, sad song, and I do feel sad after listening to that, like, I'm relating to them, like, right, that was mad, like, then I know that it was good because they've done their job with the music.
It's about feeling.
Right? It's about feeling. If it gives me a feeling, well, the lyrics could be so dead, but if I'm laughing, because it's like catchy, then I'm like, yeah, this is good. I know what this can do, even though it's not complicated, it's silly, but I get it because it's invoking that emotion in me, if that makes sense.
Is that the same process when y'all are making music that you trust yourself on how you feel?
Yeah.
Like you got so much trust in your ability to articulate this that you feel that that's going to be delivered successfully.
You know what it is? One thing Konan said to me that always resonates is as long as we are happy with it, whatever happens, happens.
Right. Facts.
100%.
Like, so he's always, I want this to sound good and good, so good that I'm happy with it. So if they're not rating it, at least I don't feel that I'd half step this.
That's how we operate.
That's just exactly how we operate.
The same thing.
Same thing.
Yeah, so as long as we're happy and we put it out and we're like, we're happy, we're good, let's go.
Right.
And we put out to the world and we are happy.
You're good with it.
We're good. Like, because I'm happy with it.
But yeah.
You guys are looking for a record label.
this will work this time. We got action. We got a proven commodity.
Now, thanks for passing through, man.
No problem, bro.
No, I love trucks, bro.
Jason, OC.
Big up, bro.
Man, love, all day, man.
Respect,
yes,
man. Y'all are amazing, man.
Love,
it's a pleasure.
Love, bro.
Real, man. Yeah,
love, bro. Guys.
I know.
We like you too, Chuckie.